I can't believe this turned out in on the winter solstice. I thought there might be 10 people coming out. I thought it's too cold. Who's stupid enough to come out on a cold night much night?
Well, we are. We are stupid.
We haven't left, so we don't know what it's like outside. We've been here, Kevin and I have been here since 8:30. So we have 16 readers tonight. Ooh. So we have to limit the reading to 4 minutes. Okay, sorry. I don't like to limit it, but we will be here till midnight if we don't. So,
it's warm.
Is everyone comfortable temperature wise?
Yes, thank you.
Cool.
For those who have been here, you would know, but there are a few newbies tonight, so I will let you know. We have 16 readers. We give each person 4 minutes. So if you feel like you want to come back next month, you can read the rest of it, okay? So keep everyone hanging for a month, that's good. You will put your name on the list, but I don't necessarily run it in that order because I like to mix it up because we don't want all poetry together and all. I like to mix it up. So if you thought you were going to be first or last, then you might not be. Also, Kev is filming this, all of the readings. If you don't want to be on YouTube, please let him know, because he does roughly... Yes, oh, so Les will be timing. See the really scary man in the black coat up the back? with the beanie? He's the timekeeper. At 3.5 minutes, he will give you a ding. And then at 4 minutes, you'll get a double ding. So you don't have to finish right on that spot. You can finish that sentence if you like, but don't keep going and going and going.
Can we hear the double ding?
Can you hear the double ding? We need to hear the double ding.
He's in form.
He's in form. It's
no reflection on you.
Winter solstice. How does anyone feel about winter solstice, or don't we care?
We're getting closer to spring.
So it's shorter stay today.
That's right.
We get more sleep tonight. We get a longer night.
Maybe.
So that means that the days are going to start getting longer if we're going to head into spring. I actually love this time of year, so. I've got so many layers on though. Okay, so there are a few things happening at Busybird, as always. The door prize tonight will be a copy of Healthy Mind. The reason this is a door prize tonight is that book number 2 of this, which is going to be a series, is coming out next month, and it's called Healthy Body. Some of you will have an invitation. I've just put some random invitations on seats. Anyone is welcome to come. There are 10 authors in the book, all from different professions, talking about what they do to keep a healthy body. So that is that. So that will be our door prize tonight. We also have the second year of the rest of the year dates for our workshops. We've got over 20 workshops coming up, so they are on the table. If you're on our mailing list, you will be told about these dates. If you're not on our mailing list and would like to be, we have a list on that table up there. What else? Les's second novel is coming out in September. I've just been told I'm not allowed to give you the date or the place yet because it hasn't been announced. So keep the ears peeled. It's early September.
You better start saving.
And speaking of Les, this is his novel. Les is the timekeeper. If you don't know Les, he's our timekeeper tonight, but he's also a prolific writer. He had this book come out 2 months ago, or less than 2 months ago, 6 weeks ago, and that's on sale if you would like to buy a copy and get it signed by him while he's here. What else? That's enough. I talk too much, don't I? Okay. We'll start with Shell.
She's
read a short story called Heart of Town. Now, Shell is actually interning with Busybird at the moment, so she's going to become part of the furniture.
I'm Shell. My thing is true stories. This is a true story adopted version by Tim Dunlop from an up-and-coming biography. It's called Heart of Town. I'll try to read fast. I was 14, cashed up and headed for town. As a teenager, I had three modes of transport: public transport, parent transport, and my bike. I sold the last on this list for the sum of $120. But in my mind, I had six $20 bills and six chances to spend big. Last week, I used one $20 bill to take my sister Emma and her friend to town. That one note bought us return train tickets, movie tickets, and lunch at McDonald's. And, ching, cha-ching, I had a dollar left over. 20 bucks could do wonders. I loved Sydney, and on this day, I was headed for her heart. So, with another second $20 bill and a jingle of change in my jeans pocket, I set out for my next spending spree. I commissioned my other mode of transport, the train, and savoured the view of blue on blue as it climbed the harbour bridge. On rails, up high, it panned smoothly over the magic water world of boats and ferries, all buzzing around their hive, the glorious Sydney Opera House. At the top of the bridge, with that view below, I felt I reached heaven. The main street of Sydney was so long that there were three railway stations to service it. Even though Town Hall Station was closer, I decided to get off at Wynyard Station so I could look up at the buildings and watch the people moving about on their journeys. I was headed for the roller skating rink, but already felt like I was gliding. I was so happy to be in town. But the crowd moved differently to me. People in grey slacks, black pencil skirts and stiff starched collars careered past tunnel vision on an unseen destination. I was only 100 feet or so from the skating rink when a sight grounded my glide. In a chair with wheels was a young guy, perhaps only 6 years older than me, struggling to move. His hands looked bent and he was calling out to the crowd. I'd never seen anyone look or act like him. I froze in the middle of the footpath so suddenly that some people tripped up on me. I couldn't understand why everyone walked past him without saying a word, even just to acknowledge him. I broke free from my gaze for a second to read the board that he had attached to his chair. It said, "Pens, 20 cents. Please help the Spastic Association." He had a cup with pens on a little bench top connected to the chair. I knew those pens. They were the blue and black Bic pens, the ones that never seemed to work. In my naive teenage mind, I couldn't help but think that if he'd had better pens, people might stop and buy one. I watched him for about 5 minutes. He was trying so hard to get someone to buy a pen. His words were hard to understand, but I could make them out. Why is everyone walking past him? I kept thinking. Can't they see he needs our help? Didn't they have a heart? I couldn't watch anymore. I reached into my pocket and grabbed every note and cent I had and stepped up and put the whole sum on his bench. I didn't speak. I couldn't. But our eyes communicated. He looked up at me and smiled. I will never forget the look of joy he had on his face. Yep, $20 could do wonders. I stepped back, then jumped forward again. I realised I'd given him the return part of my train ticket. I lurched forward to retrieve it. "Do you want a pen?" he slurred. I just shook my head. I felt so lucky not to be like him, and that right now in life, he needed that $20 more than I needed to skate. I stepped back, still facing him, then turned and walked back to the station.
Okay, Jeannie, Jeannie is going to read some short fiction, The Riders and Tranquility.
First on The Riders. Visualised small town. They came down from the mountains once a year, the riders. From a distance they appeared as any other rider. Up close, you could see them for what they were. Shadow creatures with misshapen heads, huge eyes, and claws that slashed through flesh and wood alike. The beasts they rode dripped foul saliva from a set of teeth any carnivore would be proud of. On that one night, from dusk till dawn, we stayed indoors. For those who remained outdoors after sunset. Ghost hunters from the Big Smoke came to investigate. They parked their van full of high-tech gadgets in the main street. They laughed at our tales. Just the wind, they said. Just your imagination. A trick of the light or of the dark. We knew better. The sun touched the horizon. I bid the ghost hunters farewell and retired to my home. I locked the door, pulled the shutters, switched off every light and huddled under my bed. My heart pounded. Soon I realised it wasn't my heart but the approaching hooves of the beasts. A wind whipped at my door. Footsteps paced the veranda as claws scratched along the wooden facade. Metal cut through the air and blood-curdling screams melted into the wind. Eventually it was quiet. Next morning there was no sign of the ghost hunters. The high-tech gadgets frozen at 1 minute past sunset. I drove their van to the edge of town, left the keys in the ignition, and walked home. Signal on tranquility, picture yourself on a beach. The sun burned silver in the blue sky. Scattered clouds adjusted to the breeze. Waves rolled almost in silence, ever whispering shh as they ebbed. The warm sand scrunched softly beneath the man's bare feet. He revelled in the quiet, in the simplicity and the complexity of it. Minutes ago he'd been trapped in the suffocating metropolis where he'd had to scream to hear his own thoughts. From the far end of the beach, the woman walked towards him. She greeted him with a smile, filling a hole he never knew existed. What did you see? He asked. Animals, plants, what did you see? The ocean is rich in life. A fresh water stream comes from the rainforest beyond. He hesitated. There seems to be everything we need. Is it time? She asked. He looked at his wrist. His watch was gone along with everything else, but he didn't miss it or even feel that he needed it. Yes, he answered. He took her hand and they sat together facing the water and looking up to the sky. A tiny pinprick glowed against the blue background, then began to flicker. It expanded with a blinding flash that lit up the daytime sky. Then it disappeared just as quickly, radiating ripples of light from its epicenter. I liked Earth, the woman said. So did I. 4.6 billion years in the making, we're down to the last suitable one in the universe. We've got to get it right this time.
Melody. Going to read some poetry. One is titled Arthur and the Other Murder.
As a young boy, I was intrigued with the mysteries and stories and myths of King Arthur. Just recently, I decided to do my own interpretation of some of those stories, hence Arthur. Is there anyone here who speaks Welsh? Simply, I've got some Welsh words in here, and my pronunciation will be terrible, so I apologise. Arthur. Mists of Midrin's making swirled across the vale. I was at the place of my choosing, Ynyswintrin, the Isle of Glass. I stood at the heart of my world, Avalon. Here all my yesterdays began. I grew, fen and marshland encompassed, gentleness surrounding, days of quiet sunshine sheltering. I grew, glimpsing shadows flickering past shafted light, filtering through sedge and withies, hearing hidden Cymry voices, wind whispering. I grew, my future unborn, ordained kingly intrigue, simply sunlight shrouded. Now, the winter of my days is almost done. carry on consigned to the depth of illusion in the fields of Camden. Soft, soothing strains delicately drifted from the blade I carried, unsheathed. My warrior hand caressed his hilt, burnished gold. My day, fading, rehearsing my past, I traced the shore, skirting the reeds, sensing the breeze, tasting the return of spring. In the hollow of my solitude, I heard haunting murmuring, phantom wings sigh across my serenity. Skyward searching, I saw only a trembling wind. But I knew. A lady demanded a return. It was nearly time. I felt the breath of Midrin linger on my brow. Caldefitch quivered as I lifted him high, the sheen of his edge shimmering, blinding darkness. The time became now. The waters of the lake stilled as he slid beneath. Evening's mist covered the near shore, a miasma of hidden grief. This darkening holds the beginning. I will come again when you call. This one is more mystical, I guess you'd have to say. And I invite you all to search for your own meaning in the ending. Murder. A tree once grew in a wilderness, a child of an unknown parent, a single rose within a wreath of lilies. A child crouched within the tree, covered by an older child, and the younger opened her eyes and smiled. In our dreaming, we were joined. Now I am here in the middle of the wreath's blood red. Now, the tree is here in the middle of a village green, where other children sit beneath its shade, never seeing my seeping blood. In the crisp of white, cricketers take to the pitch, and the game begins.
Before your eyes. You watch with disbelief. You want to come to terms with it, but all you have is a floor full of broken pieces of glass. The shock may last a few days, and then the pain hits. You finally realize that this is happening, unbelievable but real. You try to rationalize it, explain it, distract yourself from it, but it keeps hitting back at you until your tears can't be stopped, until you retreat into your little hole, curl up into the smallest ball you can ever be, and just let yourself go. This is a breakup. An event happens to all of us, men, women, young, old, smart, dumb, beauty, or beast. It's like a plague that no one is immune to. Once you have it, all you can do is sit and wait it out. Some of us only experience a breakup once, and then vow never to fall in love again. And for some, they go through this process over and over. For what, you ask? For love, I reply. For the feeling of being alive, for the exhilaration that love brings, for the peace of knowing that they are the one for me. And so we are happy to risk the pain that comes with it. I personally have gone through a few breakups. I guess I am one of those people who chase love and exhilaration. Although most breakups were quite painful at the beginning, they all gradually subside, and some faster than the others. Some say the recovery process is usually half the time of being in love. I disagree. I think it can be shortened. This book is designed to give you, my dear reader, the tools and skills to overcome a bad breakup quickly and effectively. This book can also be used by anyone who has lost loved ones to death. If this is the case for you, you can start
straight from chapter 4, Easy Distractions. It is recommended that you try at least one strategy in each of the chapters to get the maximum effect. To lose love is to prepare yourself for the greater love that is yet to come your way. Now you have learned and realized what you want and what you don't want, the next one is bound to be happier, more meaningful, more connected, and more stable. This breakup is just a stepping stone to the next level of your life. Time to dry those tears. And so, after 11 chapters, that's the afterwards, fly free. If you have positive energy, you will always attract positive outcomes. Steve Buckley. Can you imagine putting all your emotion pain, your anger and disappointment, your sadness and worry, your anxiety and fear in the bag and zipping it closed? Can you imagine that you now carry it over to a cliff and just simply release your grip on it? Let the bag drop. See the bag drop hundreds of meters. You can't even hear the sound when it hits ground. It's gone. Whatever it was in the past that was holding you back, it's gone. Now is the time to move on. My dear reader, thank you for reading my book. I know you really need it. If you follow the instruction in the first chapter, then this is day 10, and this is the day you close the door to the past and open new doors. Thank you.
Jim. Jim is going to read some prose poetry. It says various, I'm assuming it's various types, not called various.
Cool.
Thank you. I'd like to read some stuff I threw together. I've been in class all day and I needed some kind of an online tonight. Just in light of what's been going on in UK politics, I've walked this out a few times for the demise of Kevin Rudd and Julia Gillard. Tonight it's dedicated to Theresa May. It's called Politics. Walking within the impregnable walls that contain the halls of power, there will always be some regrettable falls and certain careers of flower. Thank you. Right, just on theme tonight, this one's called Solstice. This was written as part of, we were going to produce a annual calendar, seasonal calendar. And this was on the Chris Wallace crowd, you know, where you got together in a group. This came out of that. Illuminated long, low, red tones, backlight, skeletons of winter trees, ancient oaks and elms impart a dream time. Orange hues and shades of blue becoming darker. Clouds, purple lips, cyanosed. Time has given up, moving inexorably to a new colour and a new time, inky black. I want to touch in this one something that's very dear to my heart. I've lost a couple of dear relatives to Alzheimer's. Started off as short, story. It's turned into a prose poem, and it's called Visiting Grandma. Mummy, asked the lively five-year-old, do we have to see Grandma? Yes, we do, sweetie, tears and lower lip trembling. Querulous voice. Grandma frightens me, she sobs. You may not think so, consoling hugs and kisses, patting dampened eyes. I'm sure Grandma looks forward to your visits. You are her only grandchild. She pauses, sad reflection, Mum being delighted when she'd finally married. Victoria came shortly after. The front door breaks her reverie. Hello, girls, says husband Mike. Maya's window perfect. On the mantel, a picture. Victoria and Grandma hugging, both smiling. One smile now vacant. You not coming, Mike? Nah, sorry, too much to do. Presentation for the new client. You know how it gets. Perfunctory hugs and kisses. Bye, darling. Bye, possum. Give me love to your mum. into the car. Mommy, why is Grandma like that? And tears start to brim. What is happening, Mommy? Do you remember when you were little? And Victoria nods. We used to go over to Grandma's house, and she wasn't there. We would just go home. And we would go back later, and Grandma would be at home. She would meet us with some of her homemade biscuits or freshly baked cake. Do you remember that smell, babe? Yes, Mum. Darling, it's just the same now, but slightly different. Sometimes Grandma is at home, and sometimes, well, she just isn't. She will always be your Grandma. The car crunches slowly into the wide gravel driveway. Is Grandma home today?
Hemsworth. Paul is going to read a short story called Duck Rescue.
Ooh. True story. I'm Paul. Sunday afternoon, 26th of February 2017, we were on the homeward leg of our usual walk along the Plenty River Path. Stepping onto pedestrian bridge 6B, we heard thrashing and splashing. It came from the south side, so I moved to that rail. On looking over the side, I saw that a Pacific black duck appeared to have its head caught under rocks under the water. Instantly assessing the situation, I saw that although the duck was in the middle of the river, the low water level exposed enough rocks that I could walk out to reach it. Also, I noted that the bank was steep, with a lot of flood debris near the bottom, overgrown with grass and weeds. Still, I thought I could get down to the riverbank and out to the duck. I ran back to the end of the bridge railing and started down beside the bridge. Hanging onto the bridge girder for stability, I slithered down the grassy slope. All this time, I was wondering how many snakes were hiding in the flood debris I was about to clamber over. Moving as rapidly and lightly as I could over the debris, I was hoping any snakes were asleep and slow to wake. Reaching the bottom, I finally heard Patsy's warning, "Watch the blackberries," and looked around. There was a blackberry vine wrapped around my sock. Good thing I stopped when I did. Quickly removing the vine, I continued. Gingerly negotiating the rough rocks, I discovered that they were very slippery. I reached the duck, only slipping once to fill my right shoe with water. I checked both rocks, but couldn't move either. They were too big, or they were buried in the riverbed. The smaller one had a broken piece that looked small enough to move, but its surface was too slippery to grip. After the initial thrashing that caught our attention, the duck was still, except for a small flap occasionally. Was it urging me to hurry? Squatting down, I ran my hand along the duck's neck to its head, but couldn't maneuver it out. The gap was too small. The duck had been calm while I was handling it, but suddenly it went limp. Oh no, I'm too late. Once again, I tried moving its head, but without success. The duck suddenly moved, as if to say, "Hurry up. I can't hold my breath forever." Out of sheer desperation, I tried the smaller piece of rock again. This time, I managed to obtain a grip and was able to pull it out. However, the duck didn't move. It lay there with its head still hanging limply underwater. Lifting it up, I headed for the bank, filling the other shoe in the process. By this time, a family group had joined Patsy to watch.
Now, I know that hanging a drowned person by the ankles won't drain their lungs, but I didn't know what else to do. I tipped the duck's body vertically and a couple of drops fell off the beak. Although I returned the duck's body to the horizontal, the head was still dangling like a pendulum. Suddenly, I felt a movement in the chest. Heartbeat? No, it was breathing. Slowly, the head came up to its normal position. The duck sat placidly in my hands, looking as if it were deep in meditation. I'll stop there soon.
Thank you for that. It's probably a reality show you can have about that. What's the other one? Bondi
Rescue.
Antoinette. I can't see where Antoinette is sitting there. Yeah, Antoinette is going to read some of her book that is also coming out very soon, called Your Thoughts Matter.
Hi everyone, I'm Antoinette Pellegrini, and as Blaise said, my book is called Your Thoughts Matter, The Future You Are Creating Starts Now. It's a series of reflections, 25, on designed to basically empower the reader to consciously create the life they want to live. And I have affirmations and reflections in there too. So tonight I'm just going to read a few paragraphs out of the preface and then one of the affirmations and reflections. Okay, so this book is for anyone who is starting to question who they are and where they fit in the world. It is for those who are searching for something beyond themselves, those who may feel disempowered or unable to achieve their dreams, or for those who just feel that there must be more to life. My message is that you are more powerful than you realise, and that power is within you. You make a difference, and your influence is much greater than you imagine, and it all starts with your thinking. Thoughts are the basis of what you are creating in your life. Nothing can be done or achieved unless you think of it first. More than this, thought is an energy vibration, attracting similar vibrations. What you're thinking now is creating what and who you will be tomorrow. Your thoughts can be your best friend or your worst enemy. Every thought is an affirmation, either positive or negative. What is your self-talk saying to you about yourself? If your thoughts are not positive, you can change that. It's your choice. Rather than focusing on the negative or on what you don't have, you can make a decision that you deserve to be happy, that you are worthy, that you will view life positively and with a gratitude for everything that you do have. You are in control of what you think. No one can take this away from you. Okay, thanks. It's my hope that this book may in some way assist you to feel empowered to the person that you want to be and achieve what you want from life. So I'm going to read affirmation number 23 and reflection 23. So affirmation, I make a difference. So I make a difference. My very existence has changed the world. I have choices to make. Consciously or unconsciously, my choices will affect me and everyone around me. I'm conscious of the difference I make. I realise how powerful I am. And then the reflection that goes with that is you make a difference. You affect the future of the world. Through your existence, you have changed and will change the future. It is easy to feel small sometimes, a small being on a small planet that is part of an enormously vast universe. Yet remember, there is no one else like you. There never was, and there never will be. You are unique, and love that about yourself. We often take ourselves for granted, seeing the wonder of the nature, our earth, but forgetting that we are part of that nature. We are amazing creatures with an incredible inventive power and the ability to change our world. We often take our earth for granted. We marvel at other planets, at a crater on Mars or the rings around Saturn. These are indeed marvellous, but we forget the incredible beauty and features of our own Earth, which has given birth to the mountains, oceans, land, plants, animals, including us. You are more than one in a million. Have you ever thought about the incredible sequence of events that had to occur for you to exist? If your parents hadn't met, or your grandparents or great-grandparents, then you would not exist. If you hadn't been conceived at the exact moment you were, then you wouldn't exist. Realise how incredible it is that you have the wonderful gift of life. Is it chance that you were born? Maybe, maybe not. Either way, you have the gift of life, the certainty of making a difference in the world. The world would be a different place if you did not exist. I want you to continue.
Photographs in there, yeah, too, of her own photographs. Marcello is going to read some poetry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just counted, I've been here 40 times. And wow. I missed the first one, and then I was sick at operation, I missed the next three, so I've been here 40 times. Wow. Kevin, yeah. Is it okay to read with the clothes, or do I have to take them off?
Take them off?
That's if you watched Facebook yesterday and today, you know what I mean. What embarrass you?
I'd just like to say, everyone, today is World Nude Hiking Day.
Good luck with that.
So,
that's nothing to do with it.
Because I'm about to go on a hike, I took a photo this morning naked with a backpack on. I'm sorry.
Right.
Watch the brambles.
So, these two poems are significant because I wrote them. These events took place on the 21st of June 2003 in a volcanic island where I was born, in Genostra there. And the volcano had been very active for the past 6 months. Nobody died, but they'd evacuate the island. And and from here, it's only about 4 kilometers to the crater. Mm-hmm. And this volcano is the most active volcano in the Mediterranean Sea. Stromboli. This is part of my new little experiment. Edge of the world. Come walk with me through tall grass to the world's edge, where the coastline careens away to a restless sea below the volcano. That hulk fuming against a scarlet sundown. Come with me, climb the black back breathless, your feet trembling on the earth as an underground roar rises. There we are, javelins of flame leap into the night sky, pierce the smoky clouds, edging them fluorescent orange. We lie motionless on a rocky soil, spellbound by the burning heavens, where not at once a milky star plummets past us, blazing a trail of silver light to the sea. Stay up here with me through this night, here on the edge of the world. Witness. In the sweet, moist dawn air, I bear soul witness. Stout stalks of sugar cane rustling gusts of wind, introducing the melody of birdsong. Two lavender peaks scale a watermelon sky, formed from light, formed from air, silence, expectant as first creation. From the thighs of the sun, day is born. I'm writing on a third person, I sometimes a first person, when I went back. But this actually took place on the 2003 solstice. And we did spend the night here.
Wow.
Yeah, right, 4 kilometers from the volcano. And then every so often you see the beautiful fireworks. And then you get we used to get a lot of shooting stars, like javelins, you know, sort of. it didn't matter, and then some, because of the movement of the volcano, the sea, we hear this huge roar coming up. And it was terrifying. So we stayed there, because everything was dark, because there is no electricity there. So everything was dark. The only light we had was from the volcano. And I've got a few more that I wrote at the time, because even though I lived there before, as a youngster, as I went back, I'd appreciate it more then, 42 years later, and then I realized just how lucky I was. I didn't have to go to school, there was no school there.
Memoir, Return to Madrid.
I was with the Doris girls, and then we went from Mallorca to Barcelona to Madrid, and then while I was there, the ballet finished, but I continued on with two of the other girls to join an Argentinian ballet, so I'll continue from there. Violeta was a 6-foot-tall Argentinian with long jet black hair, lengthy legs, and a voluptuous figure. Sizzling with sex and a $1 million smile, she danced into the limelight, a star. She was firm and kind, and her choreography excellent. Louis, her husband, was a complete opposite, small and robust with brown hair and moustache, but together they made a formidable team. Their 4-year-old daughter, Alexandria, came to rehearsals, fascinated by the dancers. Perhaps she became one too. One day, Violeta called me aside. This was abnormal. Looking at her stern face, I knew trouble was brewing. Nothing was wrong with my dancing. I had no idea. Pamela, are you pregnant? What? No, I'm not. I can't have a dancer looking pregnant. Work with me. Have you looked at yourself in the mirror? You'll have to go if you don't lose weight. It hadn't occurred to me that the rich Russian salads overflowing with mayonnaise, Spanish tortillas filled with juicy potatoes, onions, peas, and other veggies, saturated in our oil, eaten with crispy bread, could affect my figure. Returning to the dressing room, in the mirror, I saw an image of a plump young girl with a balloon belly ready to pop outside of a jewel bikini. Petrified at the thought of losing my job, I decided on a rigid crash diet. Milky coffees and eggs were nourishing and would give me the stamina to dance without food. The first boiled egg without salt was devoured in slow motion, each morsel relished, and the sugarless cafe latte revolted. Hunger pains started with a gnawing sensation in the gut. The second day the pains became too intense. Faint, I bought another egg and drank a second sugarless cafe. On the third day, the pain mellowed as the craving for food dissipated, and I continued this regime for 3 weeks. Costumes began to fit, but the problem was mental. Passing restaurants and cafes, the smells and aromas taunted me. One night, Violeta said urgently, "Pamela, I must speak to you." "I'd done nothing wrong this time." "Pamela," she sighed, you lose weight too quick. You must eat. You look like a skeleton." "No, I must lose weight. Tonight I'm taking you home with me to eat vegetables." Together with 4-year-old Alexandria and Louise, I sat at her table as she poured hot, steaming vegetables onto our plates. Watching young Alexandria pick up her fork to eat the hot vegetables, I hesitated. "Eat," demanded Violeta. The food slithered down my throat, soothing the withered stomach as I returned to normal.
Kitty is going to read her story, because Kitty's doing a book as well. What's a book's about to be born? And I think you're doing a song. You're going to do a song, we'll see.
I've got time, but yeah.
I haven't really done it. going to wing it a bit. So I'm going to be sharing a little bit about my story and how this came about, writing this book called Juggle Health and Wealth, Keeping All Your Balls in the Air Successfully. So basically, how that came about is because since a very young girl, health has been something very, very important to me, because I was born with a hole in my heart, which is basically, a degenerative disease that was, a natural hole there. So that caused me, since a very, very young girl, to be really feeling inferior all the time, because I couldn't even do any form of exercise. Whereas my brothers, they were very, very good, like in the athletic skills and things to do with physical education. So to me, since I was very, very young, I always learned about health in all different areas. Like I would be devouring books about health and wellness in all different areas, including not only just physical health, but emotional, mental, physical, social, and psychological. So when I was at uni, I studied psychology and I did nutrition. And also, I lost my dad when I was only 16 years old of cancer. So that furthered my desire to learn about health. So with that, I actually also learned about the importance of living well. A lot of people, when you think about wealth, what do you think about? Money, right? Or financial resources. To me, living well is not only about money. It's also about, being able to live a life of joy, happiness, and to have, satisfaction, contentment, gratitude, and all sorts of things that make your life sing, and like with heart full of gratitude and thankfulness. And obviously, financial resources are important, but to me, I feel like, the process along the way is just as important as reaching to the destination or whatever your goals are. So one of the songs that I really love that in our 48-hour retreat that we sing is called The Greatest Love of All. And Zoe inspired me because she's got this heart, and the heart is about love. And Natalie, who is the my author mentor, also inspired me. And since that time, that song has been in my head, all the time, and I love singing that song. So I'll just give you a bit of that song, and until the time's up, because it's quite a long song. So I'll just sing without music. So it's The Greatest Love of All to dedicate to you all. I believe that children are our future. Teach them well and let them lead the way. Show them all the beauty they possess inside. Give them a sense of pride to make it easier. Let the children's laughter remind us how we used to be. Everybody's searching for a hero. People need someone to look up to. I never found anyone who fulfilled my needs. A lonely place to be, and so I learned to depend on me. I decided long ago never to walk in anyone's shadows. If I fail, if I succeed, at least I live as I believe. No matter what they take from me, they can't take away my dignity. Because the greatest love of all is happening to me. I found the greatest love of all inside of me. And if by chance that special place that you've been dreaming of leads you to a lonely place, find your strength in love.
Gay. Gay says, not sure yet. Do you know what you're reading now?
Not sure. Not sure that I'm making microphones.
Yes, you can.
Very much.
Thank you for that beautiful song. I do love that. I don't know it as well as you do. I'd love to sing that. I'm going to say a poem first, and then I was going to sing a song, but not as beautiful as that one. Right.
Jay has two books available for sale.
Yes.
Well, number one sold out, but we're getting more printed.
$20 each on special at $30. This is a poem about weight, because I'm obsessed by my weight. Look at me, my weight's growing free. I cannot fit into my clothes. My bottom follows far behind me, and I can no longer see my toes. I've tried to eat so healthily with only treats of chocolates and cheese, but lately I've noticed a development of dimples around my knees. I decided to join a weight loss club. Excited, I paid my fees, but shocked, I learned at a greater cost there was no chocolate and cheese. I made a brave decision to give the diet a try, but after examining the menu, I only wanted to cry. Pickled carrots and tofu and green cabbage stew, and lots of lentils and shoots of fresh bamboo. On reflection, I don't think this club's for me. No, there's really no decision to make. I've thought it through very sensibly and decided one cannot have life without cake. And if I could find it, by the little one, I can't find it. No.
Do you need your manager out there?
Probably. So I can't find it. Never mind. I'll just sing my little song that I've wrapped in this week. If you're in Arizona, I'll follow you. If you're in Minnesota, I'll be there too. I'll have a million chances to start anew, because my love is endless for you. And my heart cries for you, sighs for you, dies for you. And my arms long for you, please come back to me. The bloom has left the roses since you left me. The birds have left the window since you left me. I'm lonely as a sailboat that's lost at sea. I'm lonely as a human can be. And my heart cries for you, sighs for you, dies for you. And my arms long for you. Please come back to me. We had a silly quarrel, that's what we had. We have to learn to live with the good and bad. Together we are happy, apart we're sad. Those loneliness is driving me mad. And my heart cries for you, sighs for you, dies for you. And my arms long for you. Please come back to me. Thank you very much.
Carol is going to read a poem called Voices.
I've been a vocalist entertainer for about 30 years, but I've never done this, read my own poem to writers. So it's a little bit scary. But also, as well as being a vocalist, I had a lot of administrative roles while I was trying to make a living singing, and I often use my voice in telephone work. So this is a subject that I know a little bit about. Voices whispering through prison bars, voices soaring in domestic showers, voices smoky, gravel and thin, in confessionals speaking of sin. Voices supple, wet and rich, voices of the quarrelling bitch. Football commentators screech out loud. Bag ladies slur about dreams that soured. Voices comfort a frightened child. Discipline teenagers rebellious and wild. Voices soft, croon deep and low. Voices of young girls, sweet and demure. Voices of Aussies, obnoxious and ochre. Voices of the stern, arresting copper. Telephone voices, frequently breathy. Other times raunchy, often sexy. Voices with accents, voices disguised. Voices that flatter, then tell you lies. Voices that instill or relieve our fears. Voices that somehow banish our tears. Voices of the religious, often fanatical. Of the protester, hippie and radical. From this abundant mosaic of choices, we decide how we make use of our voices.
Thanks, Carol. Marie Lucic. I think Marie's going to read from her galaxy chart.
I actually did prose.
Okay.
I changed my mind.
Okay.
So.
That's okay.
So I've been working on the Heaven Station Silver Braille for about 3 years, and it has become an exceedingly elusive kind of concept. Last night my husband said to me, the light's on in there, you left the light on. And, you know, I opened the door, somehow the door had closed. And today, when I went to look for my two elusive, wonderful manuscripts, they had both disappeared, so they'll probably be back there when I return. But the Silver Grail is an angelical process, and we look at our ancestors and how they achieved, you know, wonderful outcomes and success in their lives, and then we develop strength from that and resurrection. And then I've unpacked all of my poetry, and the whole thing came to fruition with the birth of an angel the other day when we went to see Wild Boar at the Malt House. And there was a row of asses, and it was like women in labour, but they were talking and everything. I had a wonderful story to tell you about that. However, I can maintain my dignity and just read a strength, because the two very elusive Silver Grail sacred tomes have disappeared. All right, so, old rhymes. Didn't think I had it in me till this poet came along. Since she lit the poetry within me, I've been screeching harebrained songs. Even though you didn't think I had it in me, those years of elocution drove me to enunciate the lines of Banjo Patterson's old rhymes. They didn't think I had it in me. Those examiners spoke Welsh, and though I was only 4 back then, I swore I'd love to teach elocution myself. My brothers didn't think I had it in me, but this poet lit the spark. Life's not been the same since then, she's really left me in the dark. So what do I do with these silly lines? Do I sell them by the rhyme? Or do I stick to blank verse? Could there be anything worse? They didn't think I had it in me to write silly old verse poetry. But lines keep multiplying like headstones in the cemetery. But now I know I have it in me since this poet came along. Life simply not been the same since then. Poetry's really left me in mayhem. Okay, perseverance is the next one. Persevere, never give up, no matter the obstacles, no matter how difficult the situation, continue to persevere despite severity of circumstances, sadness and happiness, death and birth, career and a verisimilitude of obstacles, a pastiche of colourful disasters, persevere, triumph, overcome obstacles, shrink them into a minute of mustard particles, transform these obstacles into ants, dying ants. Perseverance is a necessary quality in a world of flux, a spinning world of disintegrating lives, of conflict and turmoil. All right, reflection. This is about the concept of seamlessness. I have this wonderful idea that we should have a seamless existence where we work in harmony, but the truth is, with a marriage of opposites, it falls apart. It really does. However, as an idea that we work as a team, it's a good idea, and I'm looking at it in relation to editing as well. Since I wrote, I'll just read things. So, invisible brush, dusts, silken webs from corners, flawless poetry, non-traceable changes, slot into the jigsaw seamlessly. A resonating voice, a refined poem, invincible. That's it.
Nandita is also working on a book.
I just have to say, Kev did a wonderful work on the cover, so just watch that. That's really nice.
Thank you.
And to Blaise. I think last time I spoke about meteorizing, it's based on a 16th century saint. And so it just transformed into, in short, it is a love story, as today it's being the theme of love here. Wonder Woman believes in love too, so why not love? And it's basically not only a human, it's God involved in it. So it's a love triangle, a woman, a man, and a God. Let's see who gets it. Who gets Mira? All right, so this is basically from... I'm not used to reading from mobile, but... It's called The Rejection, and I'll just had it there, sorry. The suppressed feelings, the self-pity, sitting in a corner alone, slightly ashamed, slightly proud of his achievements. He looked at the empty wine glass. He felt empty and hollow, just like it. The only difference was that he was not made of glass, but still more fragile than ever before, waiting to be shattered into a million pieces, if touched by just a drop of love. What would become of him if Mira fell in love with him? Would he be able to match or withstand the strength of her love, or would he be doomed forever? The deliberate short kisses, the odd strokes of her hair, the feel of her breath, the softness of her face, those eyes of Mira's from which he wanted to see the world from. He was making it all impossible for himself. Would he die if he made love to her? Just a glimpse of himself making love to her tormented him every day. Mira was like a forbidden fruit. He wanted for a miracle to happen. He counted in his mind, 1, 2, 3. And then, sorry, I'm just reading, because I'm reading from a page. I just lost track. I think I'll leave it there because I can't get through that. But just wait for the book to come. You will find out what happens.
Steve is going to read. Is it from your novel? From your novel. Night at the Dam.
Right. Well, yeah, got a published novel. The novel is about how a married father of six in Dublin, Ireland gets caught up with the collection of the Pope. And this is my main protagonist, Peter MacDonald. He's, as I said, he's got six children. And he's 41 years old, they've decided it's about time he has a vasectomy. So the day before his vasectomy, he wants to relax a bit, so he goes to the pub where he knows his mates are going to be there. He believes his mates don't know anything about the vasectomy, it's all a big secret. So anyway, this is... just a warning, there is some graphic text in there about procedures gone wrong. A bit of blocker in there to his time travel, so... The Dan, as it was commonly known, was typical of most suburban Irish pubs and had a loyal following. Its appearance decor was little changed when it was constructed in the 1920s. The red brick facade consisted of two picture windows and a simple wooden door. The door opened to a small foyer and a pair of swinging doors then led directly into the main bar, which was an almost square room. The timber-paneled dado wall matched the timber-paneled bar, which sat directly opposite the entry. Above the dado walls on each side was an eclectic assortment of advertisements for various ales and liquors. Some obviously dated back to when the pub was first opened, but others were quite contemporary. An area to the left of the bar was preserved for playing darts. Peter arrived at 7:15 p.m. to find Niall Brady, Paul Tyson, Rob Kennedy and Ron Kennedy sitting at their usual table and most of the way through their first pints. "Hey, Macca," Rob called out as he arrived. "You're around, mate," added Niall immediately after. "We're actually Irish, I can't do Irish accents." It's probably so funny in Irish, but anyway. "Hang on, Niall," said Paul in a concerned tone. "Shouldn't we be buying a pint for the condemned man?" "Right you are," replied Niall. "A man shouldn't have to pay for his last pint." Paul stood up and pulled an empty chair out for Peter, supporting his arm as he sat and said, "You just sit down here, Macca, and I'll get you a pint. The good Lord knows you've earned one tonight." Peter looked suspiciously at Paul as he walked to the bar, then turned to face Robert Niall, who was seated opposite him at the table. "What are you fecking idiots on about?" he said. "Aye, we all know you're in for the snip tomorrow," answered Rob. "Who told you?" "It's all over the school," Niall added. "All the mothers are talking about it. My missus heard it from Rob's missus." "Well, so much for keeping secrets," Peter said despondently. "I must say," continued Niall, "I wouldn't have thought a good Catholic boy like you would go for such a thing." "Yeah," added Rob. "You and Mary, you're putting us all to shame. I thought you'd keep going, at least you hadn't even a dozen." Peter sat forward and raised his finger to respond to Rob's remark, but Niall added, "And it's a good thing you finally worked out that you don't need to make a baby every time you do the business." Putting aside what I was going to say to Rob, Peter now turned his attention to Niall. "For your information," he said, "I don't think that you have to make a baby every time you do the business. However," a smirk appeared in his face, "once you've had six of the little beggars, it certainly seems like it." "I can relate to that," laughed Niall. "I've only had three. But seriously, you being on the parish council and all that, aren't you worried you could get excommunicated or something?" "Firstly, Niall," responded Peter, "it was meant to be a secret. And secondly, if the church was going to excommunicate every Irish Catholic that practiced birth control, there wouldn't be any else left, would they?" "Right you are," affirmed Niall. "I think I'll leave it there." So I didn't get the graphic bits. So.
Back next month just to find out. Now, Brian, I'm going to read some of Brian McGrath's poetry because he's having trouble with his eyes. So, this is called "The Photograph in Camera." "The seeing eye is never still. It moves in space and covers time. From coloured moment to coloured moment, sleep does not rest. For memory is always sleep's invited guest. Then capture light, the eye commands. A cyclops must a hunter be. Time's silent prison photograph is time's emancipus and epitaph. By holding moment frozen, it makes it free, preserved for all time's later moments to observe. Thus does this happy moment win immortality, far beyond the slippery grasp of memory. But if the photograph is blurred, what in time has then occurred? Was the moment really seen to waver? No, the moment now is indistinct, overflowing with inner tension, only because its new dimension is not one but several moments, intermingling, softened by their blending at the edges. The seeing eye is hunter, always hunter. The moving, living present is its prey. It seeks, like man, to touch the timeless in today." That's by Brian. Lillian is going going to read an excerpt from her new novel. Mm. Ooh, ladies.
So, just a little bit of backstory here. Last September, I started teaching a novel writing course at CAE, and I thought I'll write a novel as well, you know, as you do. So I picked one out of my filing cabinet that I'd been working on for a while and got writing and finished writing it at the end of November when the course finished. I beat all my students. And a couple of weeks later, I'll just tell you the name of the novel first. The title of the novel is Greener Grass. And it's a fiction about a woman whose marriage is kind of on the rocks and what happens from there. And a couple of weeks after writing this novel, a new man came into my life. And a few weeks later, my marriage of 29 years came to an end. And I'm in a new relationship. So I've had a very, very interesting time of the last sort of 6 months of life imitating art, or whatever it is, one of the two. So this new novel, Greener Grass, is going to be launched probably in about August or September, and I've got a little thing here if you'd like to come to launch. You can put your details on there. And I'm just going to read you a little bit of an excerpt from the first chapter. So, he was at the counter. She wove through the aisle toward him with the two steaming cups reaching him as his case jerked away on the conveyor belt, and he thanked the check-in attendant and stepped away. They had another few minutes before he had to pass through the final door, so they hovered, sipping their drinks, watching people walk past or gather in knots to talk. A large Indian family had stopped nearby and she admired the women's saris. A couple of 20-somethings wearing backpacks strolled past. She nudged John. Bring back memories? He followed her gaze and nodded. Seems so long ago now, an age, she mused. It was, he said. There was a truckload of significance in those two words. A cavernous space opened up and their 9 years together toppled into it, dragging her doubts and questions with them. A happy age, a worthwhile age, or a big mistake? She teetered back and forth between those options herself. No relationship was only happy, of course. You'd be stupid to expect that. But there had been so much doubt, especially lately, so much frustration on both sides, she guessed, although he didn't talk much about what he was feeling. She had to comb her memories to find the happy, contented moments these days. They were becoming increasingly lost in the tangle of what? Regret? Disappointment? She remembered that day in Spain when they'd had to say goodbye and had clung together, making promises to stay in touch because the connection had been so exactly right, like two puzzle pieces fitting together with a little click of confirmation. And then he had followed her to Australia, turning up out of the blue with that beam, those beautiful hazel eyes shining. Surprise, I couldn't get you out of my mind. I love you, I want to be with you. Let me share the rest of your life. And if it wasn't as if she had anyone else, and definitely there was something between them, some real genuine love and friendship, and it's no small thing to have someone follow you across the world declaring their love, she couldn't say she agreed to marry him just because she was flattered. That wouldn't be true, but there was an element of it. I'd better go, John said, crushing the empty cup in his hand and reaching for hers. He'd already spied a bin. She watched as he walked to it and tossed the cups in. That walk, the slim frame, the erect head, the slightly turned out feet. Going home to England for 3 weeks. She couldn't deny the rush of delight that recurred at this thought. Space, freedom, relief from constant heaviness as they bumped up against each other's frustration. And then they were facing each other and his hands were encircling her upper arms as he regarded her steadily. I'm sorry, he said, I haven't been much fun lately. She conceded this with a little sign of assent. Lots on my mind, he said. I know, she said, me too. Lots to talk about when I get back. I just need to get this over with. Yes. He bent down and kissed her softly on the lips, put one hand against the side of her face, cradling it. She melted a little. Take care, Mia. I do love you. Tears pricked her eyes and she hugged him. I know. I love you too. But geez, it would help if we were having some fun, she didn't say. Instead of all this same old and seriousness and nothing new or fresh. John released her gradually, letting her hands go last, his gaze drinking her in as if to form an impression that would stay with him for the next 3 weeks. Then he picked up the satchel with his book and laptop and walked to the international departures doorway, turned back to smile and wave, and then continued on through it.
Anyone come in after we...
Jimmy.
Jimmy, are you going to sing?
Yep.
You got a song for us?
Raise your hand.
Yeah? Come on down.
Lisa says she'd like to read too.
Who?
Lisa.
Me. Do you want to read Lisa? But is he just doing your pain? Yeah. Okay. That's it for the reading. So if you want to come down, Jimmy, that would be great.
Do the raffles.
Maybe we can do the raffle tickets. Yeah. While we're so if everyone wants to dig out their raffle ticket while Jimmy gets ready.
The camera.
Do you want to do it or not? Do you want to be on or not? There you are.
Everyone got their tickets? Ready? Are they all the same? Are they all green?
Yep.
A04.
Hey.
Oh!
I've never won anything before.
Very exciting. Here we go. Anybody
announcements or anything they want to tell anybody
while we can? I'm pregnant.
Did you get that?
Is it Robin's? Do you need to run in? So Jimmy's going to sing. I'll let Jimmy tell you.
No doubt, I might one day, but I've spent most of my time either playing a guitar or come up with some new lines for my new song. And by the way, thank you to both of you, Kevin and Blaise, for telling everybody about my gig a couple of weeks ago, which was a sellout. So thank you very much. And I'm gonna do this song is about love, about relationship. Challenging part about a relationship, how we always go through, we thought we had everything, but sometimes we don't. I think some of you have been in a relationship long enough, you would know what I mean. Your love was complete. Just when you thought your love reached its peak, just when you thought you know each other's needs, there's more to love than this. Do, 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 love picks you up when your love is hearty sweet. Love drops you down when your words don't agree. Love tears you apart when your love meets deceit. That's when find your love heart to give.
Well,